Even if you've never seen FLCL, you've probably heard of anime's baddest girl in the galaxy, the first class space patrol officer, Haruhara Haruko.
Ah, it's you, the Vespa woman!
Hi, Haru-san.
Haruhara Haruko.
Haruko!
I bet she does it like a weasel.
Haruhara Haruko.
Haruko-san!
Haruhara Haruko.
Haruhara Haruko desu.
Yeah, Haruko-san.
Anjinyu.
Haruko, pleasure.
Known to be selfish, opportunistic, irreverent, and comically uncaring of the fate of the galaxy, Haruko has a lot of people thinking she's actually the villain of FLCL. But even if she does start that way, it's not safe to assume that she didn't learn anything or change by the end. So to fully understand Haruko's character arc, though, we have to know exactly what she wants and how she tries to get it. So in order to absorb the Pirate King of Tomsk, Haruko has to bash sexually frustrated people on the head with her guitar to open a portal called an NO channel to the inside of the Medical Mechanica plan and hope Adamus comes out instead of a hostile robot bent on retaliation. Got it? Good. Guitars plus emotions equals wormholes. Now, in episode 1, Adamus doesn't automatically come out of Naota's head when he's hit, making him useless to Haruko. But given enough time, Adamus' mind channeled into a medical mechanical robot is able to come through, though his presence is short-lived because Haruko mistakes him for the enemy and bashes his head open. In episode 2, new horns appear on Naota's head, but there was never any chance of it being Adamus. The episode is all about Mamimi's obsession with Kanti and how Naota is jealous of them and seemingly powerless to change that situation. He doesn't feel free or like an adult here. He feels trapped, and the mindset of the subject can affect what is allowed through the NO channel. So although Haruko had been buttering up Naota for most of the episode, he'd already taken issue with Mamimi's behavior and developed that hairy chip on his shoulder. Ew. In episode 3, Naota's cat ears get transferred to Ninomori via a branching NO portal that opens up when they smack heads in this scene. And since Ninomori has a very similar set of mixed up emotions, a robot is able to come out of her as well, but it's still not Adamus. You know, all Haruko wanted to do was open an interdimensional portal to move something from point A to point B. You'd think it'd be easier than all this nonsense. What's a girl gotta do to catch a bird around here? And I think that's really the turning point for Haruko. In episode 4, she's fed up by now and goes through with a much less subtle plan. She knocks a covert bomb satellite out of orbit and into a collision course with the Medical Mechanica plant. After all, if Adamus is powerful enough to pull planets to him from light years away, he'd surely survive a bomb only big enough to level one city, right? She doesn't give a single fuck about Mabuse, or Earth for that matter, and now that Naota's confirmed useless, she has no qualms about making him the satellite's target and leaving his father for dead in the process. But just as she's about to make her big getaway and see Adamus burst out of the exploding iron, Naota does actually swing the bat. By channeling Adamus through Kanti, he has the power to not only stop the bomb in its tracks, but to give Haruko the idea that he may just be worth something to her. So she jumps back up and hits the bomb back into space, hoping she can pull Adamus out of Naota's head later on, but why does she do this? She doesn't care about anybody but herself, and allowing the bomb to explode right there would give her access to Adamus now, so why show Naota even the tiniest shred of mercy when her goal is inches from her grasp?
What? You're saying I have personal feelings for him?
Well, yes. In episode 5, Naota walks in on Haruko getting berated by her space police superiors through an improvised cat walkie-talkie. And even though we don't know exactly what they're asking, when I hear this line, which I'll play again in full now...
What? You're saying I have personal feelings for him? I don't think so. Well, the reason this mission has been delayed is because the channel to NO is still open. It's not about liking or disliking. Damn, connection with dead.
I can't help but think they're asking the same question I just posed about the satellite bomb. It's clear that Haruko admires the maturity Naota has the potential for, and his bravery shining out past his quiet, glib exterior was enough to make her rethink murdering him and everyone he loved. So since teasing him with the idea that she might have been fucking his dad worked out so well, she goes along with Kamon's plan for an airsoft battle. But between Naota's newfound confidence going straight to his ego, and that transformation making him a little less compatible with what Mamimi uses him for, his expectations get the better of him and his emotions burst out into the biggest dick-looking robot we've seen yet. But when Naota finally gets over his attachment to Mamimi, he's able to channel much more of Adamus' power through Kanti, to the point where he can remain in Kanti's hull much longer after Naota is expelled from it. And Haruko is all about this, so much so that the two fuck off for months and leave everyone else in the dust. Episode 6 opens on Naota, alone again and spiraling downward about never escaping his hometown. But Adamus' connection to Kanti doesn't last forever, leading Haruko to rear her head again and drop back into Naota's life on a whim. But he can't simply enjoy her return and go back to how it was before. He challenges her proposition to run away with her, asking her why she's being so nice. but her response is so expected at this point that he can't bear to hear it anymore. He knows he can't have what he really wants from her, but is willing to take what he can get. And at the same time, Haruko is realizing just how much of an effect she's had on Naota, and knows it may pose a problem in freeing Atomisk. The longer she lets this go, the harder Naota will fall when she finally reaches her goal. Throughout the OVA, she's always had a sly one-liner when met with a problem, but when challenged to be honest with herself, she's completely silent. In her determination to free Atomisk from Medical Mechanica, to eat Atomisk and gain absolute freedom, she's stepping on people along the way. And in this scene, she's seeing the effect it has, wrapping itself around her torso. But she doesn't know how to make it right and still get what she wants. That's why they both speed off the next morning.
It's the climax!
With Naota wrapped around her finger and the terminal core coming ever closer to activating the iron, Haruko knows she's extremely close to seeing Atomisk. She makes it clear that she doesn't care about Earth, but we already know she bears some guilt for what she's done to get to where she is. So when Atomisk is finally supposed to appear and Naota crawls out of Kanti's screen imbued with his power, well yeah, Haruko flies off the handle and into a rage, but let's not forget the details of how that fight actually goes down. Haruko rushes in and they clash for a while, but Naota gets the upper hand by disarming her and sending her falling onto the metal roof of the plant. She's nowhere near defeated here though. We've seen Haruko get shot out of a giant gun and into the ground and electrocuted with a giant taser. She comes back in one piece all the time, so why does she simply stand and give up here, allowing Naota the option to deal the final blow? Because Haruko's most basic values always point to freedom. It is her absolute ideal, and though she is willing to do anything to get it, which is itself an exploration of freedom, she will face a moral quandary when limiting the freedom of others. That's what the Galaxy Space Police Brotherhood is all about, maximizing individual freedom and minimizing homogeneity. So it makes sense that she would join a group like that and eventually find out about an opportunity such as saving Atomisk. In that moment where Naota is rocketing towards her, and she just stands there waiting to get decimated by this kid who she'd strung along and abused for months, you'd think she'd regret everything and want to redo it all differently. But before she knew Naota was going to stand down and kiss her at the last moment, this is what she was thinking. To be defeated by you, you who took the power I wanted so bad and fought me with it. There's nothing that can be done about it now because I used you. You betrayed me, but I don't regret doing it. I knew how senseless the things I've done were, and I did them anyway. I don't expect to be forgiven, but no one has the power to forgive me anyway. No one has the power to punish me. The way of the Brotherhood is to live by one's own values. That's the difference between that evil Medical Mechanica and us. We both do bad things, but they make up excuses for their evil deeds. Their machines have a weak spirit with their forgiveness of others, their unsatisfactory value system, and their inside-out, obsessive, extremist equality. So, Takun, do what you will. Under the name of your justice, turn that super weapon against me. This insight from Fulikuli's screenwriter Yoji Enokido proves to me that not only did Haruko have an unexpected affection for Naota, but also that she's always lived by a commendable moral code, never infringing upon what other people value, but never apologizing for doing things her own way. No true villain could ever think like that. Haruko's resolve for freedom may come from a pretty selfish, morally reprehensible place, but by the end of Fulikuli, she learns that she can't be for absolute freedom while squashing down the freedom of others. That would make her no better than Medical Mechanica. And that is why Haruko is not the villain in Fulikuli.